Well, good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Library and University Research Services, welcome and thank you for joining in our panel discussion this afternoon. Our panel discussion is called Open Access: The Good, the Bad, and the Unknown. We've gathered a panel, one of whom is joining us from the UK via Skype. And they are representing different perspectives, different experiences with open access. And we're going to introduce each one to you shortly. Our goal today is to ignite a robust discussion that will continue well beyond Open Access Week. Our panelists will address a variety of questions and themes, and we are going to make sure there's an opportunity for you to join in the discussion during the panel. We've asked the panelists to do something that is a bit difficult when you've got lots of experience to share, and that's to hold their remarks to 4 minutes each. So to help them do that, we have a timer at the front of the room. She is going to set her timer as soon as they start talking, and I believe she's going to give you each a one-minute warning mark. So if you could watch for Sandra, I don't know if you have particular hand motions or...
1 minute, and then there is a tone that will come up, and I might also be... And I think maybe for all of you that the best seeing me, I might go to the back. I think that's a good spot. Would it be prefer I'm in the just because I'm afraid you might not look.
Well, probably at the front is good then. Yeah. This event is being audio taped, and so it's going to be available if you want to listen to it again. And we'll also have it available so that we can share it with people who can't be here with us this afternoon. We're also tweeting so that we can share this discussion in real time, and you can participate at hashtag OAW2015QueensU. And now, it's my pleasure to introduce our moderator, Karina McInnes, Executive Director of University Research Services. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. Just delighted to see so many people here today. Can you hear me at the back of the room okay? Okay, perfect. So it's my pleasure to be able to introduce our panel members and the themes of discussion for today. And again, you have 4 minutes, panel members, but I'm sure you'll do a great job of summarizing what you need to say today. So first, the first theme is open access to research outputs. And specifically, we're really looking at publications, and we're talking about the costs, benefits, and opportunities for authors. And we're going to have two speakers, one being Professor Simon French. He is a Queen's faculty member in the School of Rehabilitation Therapy, and Simon's at the end. And next, we will have Professor David Maricombe Wood, Queen's faculty member, Department of Sociology. And then we're going to transition to theme number two, which is tri-agency open access implementation, compliance, and implications. And under that theme, we're delighted to have Jeremy Geelan with us here from SHRC. He is a policy analyst, Social Sciences, Humanities, and Research Council. And also Professor Carrie Rowe, Queen's faculty member in the Department of Civil Engineering. The third theme is emerging models in digital scholarship, research, publication, and open science. And our first speaker will be Mr. Brian Hole, founder and CEO of Ubiquity Quest Press, sorry, from the UK. And hi, Brian. He's joining us on Skype. And then second, we will have Dr. Nasser Saleh, head of the Engineering and Science Library, but also ambassador of the Open Science Framework. Thank you, Nasser. And then the next theme, well, we'll have a bit of a panel discussion after that. And then we're going to transition to another theme, which is, what should Queen's do to support research, dissemination, and fund open access requirements? And we have two speakers with us. One is Ms. Rosarie Coughlin, scholarly publishing library from Queen's. And second, Jeff Moon, data librarian Academic Director, Queen's Research Data Center. So welcome, everyone. And we will now start with our first panel member, Dr. Simon French. So my question for you, Simon, is you are the editor of an open access journal published by Biomed Central, which is called Chiropractic and Manual Therapies. From an author's perspective, please, can you speak about some of the benefits as well as the challenges of choosing open access journals as opposed to the traditional subscription-based journals? Simon. Either way, wherever you wish. Oh, it's at the podium. Here you go. Okay, perfect.
Thanks. Starting the timing now. Thank you. Thanks, Karina, and thanks Sharon and the organisers for the opportunity. So I'm coming from an author's perspective, but I'm also going to just give you a quick overview of an editor's perspective as well. So I'm a deputy editor-in-chief of this journal. It's called Chiropractic and Manual Therapies, as Karina mentioned. I don't think anyone in this room is interested in the journal per se, but you might be interested in the model, our business model particularly. So we were a very small print-based journal that's obviously clinically specific with a particular clinical discipline in mind. It was based in Australia. We had 1,000 members of this professional society, and we produced a print journal which we mailed out to our members who invariably didn't read it, who invariably chucked it put it in the rubbish bin. So we worked out that from a financial perspective, we could actually publish our journal with Biomed Central for about the same cost, and we didn't have to charge our authors the publication fee. So the other note about this is we're not covering some of the concepts of open access necessarily, but this is the gold access, if you like, the gold model of open access. So this is full open access, copyrights held by the author, and it's immediately available upon publication. So over the last sort of 8 to 9 years, we've been developing this journal. It's now an international, very popular journal in our discipline. And we've now got four professional societies who, I'm just going to see whether that's the logos over on the side, who support this journal. So we still have the model where we don't have to charge our authors publication charges. With Biomed Central, the range of charges are from US$700 to $2,500. So we're able to offset that cost by having the professional association pay for that on behalf of the authors effectively. So that's going very well, and I think that's a nice model for a very specific clinical discipline. So the rest of my 2 minutes left, I just wanted to, just from my perspective, both an author's and an editor's perspective, just talk about some of the benefits I see of open access and then the challenges. The benefits are, the first one's very obvious, of course, maximum visibility and exposure, and particularly at the time of publication. So as soon as it's published, you can send out the notification of the publication to anyone, and then everyone can access that freely and without charge. As an author, we retain copyright of the content, so we can do anything we want with it effectively, send it to our friends. We're able to share without restriction to colleagues, to the general public, from our clinical discipline. You know, the clinical discipline is private practitioners who are self-employed in a small business. They're certainly not going to have access to funds to support subscription to journals, so we can just give this to them immediately. Enhanced visibility, potential for greater use, and of course then our research has got greater impact in the community. Yes, I won't cover those ones because we can talk about that later. So the challenges, the biggest challenge for me is the cost. So obviously not related to our journal, although the professional associations are bearing an increased cost. Lots of research is done without funding. A lot of the research I do are systematic reviews, and we use students involved in that, and I do it in my time, and then to have the fees to pay for a journal is... I'm done. I'll just quickly run through. Author charges for open access are continuing to rise. In the last 10 years, The Biomed Central average has gone from $500 US to $2,145, so it's a huge increase. When your granting bodies are certainly promoting this and will allow a researcher to apply for funds within their grant, but it's very difficult at the time of submitting a grant to anticipate how many publications you're going to get from this grant, but also that increasing charge that's going to happen. I might apply for a grant now, I might not have a publication ready for 5 years. The exponential increase in publication fees during that time are really hard to see. And the very last one I think is really interesting about predatory journals, which I hope we will talk to as well. Thank you very much.
Gold standard allows charges. And in fact, so I think what we're talking about here is a higher standard than the gold standard. And our journal is also of that standard. We do not charge for any aspect of the process at all to anyone, except ourselves, of course. And that's what we'll come back to later. The reason we started this journal simply is because back in 2001, when we were discussing it, surveillance studies was an emergent cross-disciplinary area. It didn't have a home, it didn't have departments dedicated to it, it didn't have an association, it was just a set of ideas people were discussing. So in this context, one of the best ways to get out information was to start something that was entirely open access and people could find without having to search through obscure journals in libraries and so on. And so it could be read by people also all over the world who are in the global south, who didn't have access to libraries. And from the beginning, we've tried to encourage that broad range of accessibility. Our first issue came out late 2002 and was read by over 10,000 people immediately. Academic journals do not get that kind of readership normally. And if nothing else convinces you today that open access makes a difference, that might do. Our journal has changed policy in several countries. It's actually resulted in policy discussions at high levels in several countries. Our journal sets the agenda in our field still, even now with the expansion of the discipline beyond our journal itself. So there's very good reasons why we would want to be open access in the beginning and why we want to continue that. Of course, it raises a number of questions, not least of which is cost. Where does the money come from if we're not charging anyone? Well, first of all, a lot of us involved in this consider it part of our academic job to do this. I.e., in a sense, if we are being paid fairly good wages, which we are as academics, we should be, in a sense, part of our job to get out this information in various ways. However, that's not just it. It's not just that we rely on voluntary labor of academics. We also have set up, and this is particularly to deal with the question of ownership, which is a really key question for academic journals. We didn't have an association to begin with, so we set up a special network for surveillance studies to run the journal, specifically not an association, precisely to be something slightly different and to continue that theme of being different and being a new kind of organization. That network is a registered charity. It's an educational charity registered in Britain. Therefore, doesn't in fact get tax relief on donations, which is another way we do quite well. And finally, we have a biannual conference, which brings in the most of our conventional income. And that conference, as we've become more successful, has been a very, very big event. Last time we had 170 papers in 5 tracks. And this is a small interdisciplinary conference, if you imagine it in theory, at least. However, that's still not enough. Without that, we could not employ a copy editor, for example. And you've mentioned here the lack of copy editing in your particular case. How do we do it? Well, this is where Shirk comes in. One of the reasons why I moved the journal to Canada, and one of the factors in considering moving to Queens in the first place, apart from the great job that I was being offered here, was that our journal will be eligible for Shirk funding. I think Canada is unique in the world in the way that it funds journals. And if I have anything, sort of any take-home message to Shirk and Queens and everybody else here, is this has to continue. It's absolutely essential. I think if we're going to move beyond the kind of arguments about funding in open access journals, which we'll have today, One of the ways to do that is to make sure that these costs are contributed to and partly borne by research organizations, because that's their fundamental duty, in my view, to get out academic research to the more general public, policymakers, other academics around the world. So Canada's, I can't praise the SHRC Aid to Scholarly Journal scheme enough, not least because we've been successful twice now, and hopefully we'll continue to be so. But that's our rationale, that's the way we work. We've now finally, as a result of all this hard work, a couple of seconds, which has been a lot of hard work and various forms of crises over the years, we've actually managed to get ourselves listed on all the major databases, including, as of 2 months ago, and we've still to arrange the details, Thomson Reuters Web of Knowledge, which they basically refused to have anything to do with us for years. So from a radical position of being an entirely independent journal with no charges, not part of the academics, the conventional money-making system, we've managed now to get into through the back door to the place where all journals should be. So that's our little success story. There's much more to it than that. If you want to talk to me about it afterwards or ask me questions later. Thanks, and sorry for going just over time.
Fabulous, David. A nice segue to our next theme, and the theme being tri-agency open access policy for education, compliance, and innovations. And our first speaker, Jeremy Nealon, policy analyst. So my question for you, Jeremy, is Canada's federal tri-agency recently released its open access policy and publications, requiring grant recipients awarded funding after May 1st, 2015 to make their peer-reviewed journal publications freely accessible online within 12 months of publication. For CHR, the requirements actually go back to January 1st, 2008 and onward. So I have two questions. Why has the agency decided to implement open access policies? And second, how will compliance be achieved?
Thank you, Karina, and thank you for inviting me to this event. I'm very happy to be here. I apologize for reading, but I want to stay on point and not meander through my talk, and so let it begin. The agency developed the Tri-Agency Open Access Policy on Publications for several reasons. In these brief remarks, I'll summarize some of the most prominent of these reasons as four imperatives that contributed to the agency's decision to develop the policy. The first is an ethical imperative. While it is debatable to what degree knowledge constitutes an intrinsic public good and should be freely available to all, there should be very little to debate that it is unjust to restrict citizens from accessing the results of the research they make public through their taxes. Accordingly, the agencies believe that the results of publicly funded research belong to the fullest extent possible in the public domain, available for use by others. The citizens who fund research and scholarship should be able to access the results of that research and scholarship free of charge. The second imperative concerns research and scholarship. All too often, subscription fees prevent researchers from developing countries, or indeed researchers anywhere whose institutions cannot afford subscription fees, from accessing the resources that are needed to advance their scholarship. This limits research progress, impoverishes scholarly debate, and marginalizes voices that would enrich scholarly discourse. Open access facilitates the advancement of research of the research enterprise by allowing researchers with limited access to subscription journals to read work they might otherwise be unable to afford. Open access also benefits researchers who author papers by contributing to broader dissemination of research results and higher citation rates. The third is an economic, social, and cultural imperative. Far too many academic papers, whether they concern biochemistry, business management, public policy, or art history, lie behind paywalls virtually out of reach to the entrepreneurs, businesses, policymakers, or interested non-experts who could use the insights they contain. Open access enables practitioners and the public at large to access and, as a result, to apply research findings, which facilitates economic development, social progress, and cultural flourishing. The fourth and final imperative is a budgetary one. As Peter Suber notes, subscription costs have led to several crises for research libraries. A serials crisis, which has resulted from four decades of subscription fee increases that have strained library budgets and led to journal cancellations. A monograph crisis, which results from libraries cutting into book budgets to pay for rising journal subscription fees, and the effects of which are most significant in the humanities. And a permissions crisis, where libraries risk losing online unless complete access to past issues of journals issues that they would have in the past simply acquired in physical form if they cancel subscriptions. Each of these crises can be particularly acute in Canada due to the value of our currency and currency fluctuations, and are likely exacerbated by consolidation of the academic publishing market into the hands of a few companies. Open access can help to resolve these crises by opening the door to forms of journal acquisition beyond the traditional subscription model. These four imperatives, the ethical imperative, the research and scholarship imperative, the economic, social, and cultural imperative, and the budgetary imperative, contributed to the tri-agency's decision to develop the tri-agency open access policy on publications. Now, as for compliance, I believe my time has just about run out. But at any rate, I don't have much to say about this right now. The short answer is that we're looking into the options, and the long answer is that we're looking to the options very seriously and with great interest. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeremy. Next, I'm very delighted to pose a question to Professor Rowe. Professor Rowe, you are editor of the journal Geotextiles and Geomembranes. This journal is published by Elsevier and made available to Queen's researchers via an institutional subscription paid by the library. From an author's perspective, what, if any, do you see as the main implications of funder requirements on open access publications? And a second question, what do you see as concerns with the tri-agency open access policies, or what would be an author's concern about the policy?
So, thanks, Karina.
You're welcome.
I'm going to respond to this question, starting with the fact that we have a system that has worked remarkably well for a very long period of time, although not perfect. Despite this, the granting councils are forcing us to publish in open access journals. However, there's no free lunch. Somebody has to pay. Now, at present, who's paying? Well, we have access to good libraries. The university is paying for those subscriptions, which allows us access to the best journals in the world. Journals where to publish, all you have to do is have a good research and good paper. These same journals have a gold standard if you want to have open access. In my field, it's typically $2,500 US. And yes, there are cheaper journals coming on market, in fact, all the time, begging you to submit your papers to them and pay a fee. At least in my field, those journals are characterised by one thing, the poor quality of the papers, many of which I've seen in my own journal be rejected because of poor quality. So in answer to my question, which was, what are my concerns about this as an author, it really revolves around three things. First and foremost, the cost to my research program. Secondly, the impact this is having on the quality of what's being published. And thirdly, the impact it's having on the review process itself. Now, I'm in the fortunate position of having a very large NSERC grant, probably the largest in my discipline. But if I had to pay from my NSERC grant to publish research, it would have a profound effect on the research I could do, the number of graduate students I support, and of course, therefore, the number of publications. The move to open access has caused an explosion in the number of online journals chasing papers. And they're about to publish almost anything as long as you pay a fee, including plagiarized papers, and I've had to deal with several of those cases. The number of new journals and the failure of their editors to screen before sending papers out for review is causing reviewer fatigue. And there is now growing pressure, largely from these journals who want to get things out very, very quickly, to review in 2 weeks, which is making things worse. The Common CV now requires us to declare if a paper has been published as open access. sooner or later, we'll be punished if we don't tick that box. But what constitutes open access is not entirely clear, and it's going to get muddier as time goes on. In my field, about 75% of the journals will allow you, after a period of time, to put the paper that was accepted, the pre-publication version, on a repository. But the really good ones won't. And so what does that mean? If you want to publish in the best journals, you have to pay money out of your grant if you follow this policy. That means fewer students, less research. At present, both the UK's EPSERC and NSERC and the other granting councils, NSERC's the one I know best, allow you to put your research on the research repository and have that count. But for how much longer? My friends, this is a foot in the door. Don't expect it to necessarily change. And since I've run out of time, I can't elaborate on that point, but I'd be happy to later.
Well, thank you, Kerry. You've really given us all quite a bit to think about. It's my pleasure now to transition to the next theme, the theme of emerging models in digital scholarship, research, publication, and open science. And our first speaker is Mr. Brian Hole, founder and CEO of Ubiquity Press from the UK. And welcome, Brian.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay? You can? Sorry, can anyone hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great, thanks. Okay, I'll just share my screen and I'll get going. Here we go. Okay, so I'm going to talk about, as you say, emerging models. As you can see from this first slide, we see ourselves as a publisher as one of these emerging models. If anything, we try to be a platform which enables new and emerging models to take place. So move on. And the next slide here, this cartoon that you can see here has been redacted for swear words. I hope it's still acceptable. The whole point that we're trying to get across with this is just to say that academics communicate differently. And what we as publishers try to do is facilitate academic communication. And when we set the company up about 5 years ago, we just had to decide what kind of a publisher would we be. And we thought about how does scientific communication work? And to us, it operates within what you might call the social contract of science, which means that if you are a researcher, you agree to disseminate your work, you agree to let other people validate your work, you allow them to develop it further. And there's a chap we have here in the UK called Geoffrey Bolton, who you may have met before, who says if you don't do that, then effectively it's scientific malpractice or academic malpractice. And for us as a publisher, it's very important that we enable all of these things to the maximum we can. So we don't put paywalls in front of content because that blocks dissemination. We make sure that we publish the data and the software and so forth associated with papers because that enables validation and it enables the further development, etc. So for us as a publisher, we really had to be an open access publisher because otherwise we really felt we were actually blocking scientific communication, and surely that has to be the wrong way. So we publish results, data, software, hardware, and other types of things. And so very briefly, as a publisher ourselves, we also make it very clear to people what our charges are. We have a reasonably low APC of $600 Canadian at the moment, or £300, which isn't going up. We keep that steady. If anything, our costs are going down with volume. And we're very clear about what those costs are that go into it. And our aim is to be a very low-cost, cost-efficient publisher with all of the same quality and services that you get from any of the large publishers, but we've set ourselves up not to be wasteful and to really try and deliver good value. And that's working very well. We publish now, for example, a range of open access books, which are free to read online, free to download in any format, but we regain some funding through the print copies. And we publish open access journals. These are the journals we were publishing about a year ago. The platform is growing very quickly now. These are mostly either journals that started as fully open access or about 2/3 of them have shifted over from subscription models. This is then changing quite rapidly. This is where we are at the moment. And this is where we will be by the end of the year, if I can get my slide to transition. So as you can see, our platform is growing extremely quickly. And about, about a half of those journals now come from the developing world as well, because the model is actually low cost enough that they can afford to take part, which is really, really critical in terms of open access, because the majority of the world's researchers are now in the developing world and we can't exclude them. The next slide just shows a few journals that we have in other fields, especially data. One of our concerns is opening up publication of data. So we have archaeology, psychology, health, and humanities data. But we also now publish software, bioresources, and hardware. So these are journals really trying to give people credit for sharing other types of research outputs. And then what we do is we take our whole platform. We operate as a successful publisher ourselves. But we take the whole platform and we make it available to university presses and library publishing programs to leverage. So we allow the university generally to run the front office of the press, and then we operate everything else for them to help them be sustainable and to de-risk the whole process for them. So we do everything from editorial management, copy editing, assisting with peer review, assisting with running the platform, hosting through the typesetting, indexing, archiving, etc. We then also push things automatically into the institutional repository or to data repository, so there's an automatic green archived version of the content. And we're building a large peer review network as well among the universities that work with us. So our aim is to really bring open access publishing on an affordable scale to universities at a low cost, which allows them to experiment and to try out new models. And I think, am I getting a 1 minute sign? This is my last slide.
Oh, sorry, Brian. I think is this your last slide, Brian?
Yes.
Oh, perfect. We'll give you an extra 15 seconds.
Okay. Oh, boy. So I'm going to show all the logos here. Hang on. What we do is we network up those university presses, and we allow them to have a low-cost infrastructure, share content, share resources among each other. And it's working very well. So we have things like University of California Press, paying peer reviewers, Open Library of the Humanities, not charging humanities authors at all, but using a library pays model, and others like at the bottom right, SLJOL, which is all the academic journals in Sri Lanka, being able to be online. So it's a model which is sort of enabling a lot of innovation. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. So next, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Nasser Saleh. And my question for you, Nasser, and sorry, Brian, I just realized I forgot to read out your question, but I know you saw in advance and prepared your slide deck for it. So,
yes.
But we'll cover that later. But my question for you, Nasser, is please give us a brief overview of the movement towards open science, and in particular, how this is playing out in the open science framework which you are a part of.
Okay, you can. So technically, I prefer to have some slides because I'm not sure if you're familiar with this framework. So I just give you an idea what this framework is all about. So I'm here actually representing the Open Science Framework as an ambassador. So I'm not working for them. I'm just like the idea. I've been involved, like in Helsi, some projects involved, and I would like actually to see a project coming up from Queen's University there as well. So the platform is technically like many other software you can consider. It's actually a place where you can start your research, put your data, have a collaboration medium, and also to have a peer review module inside it. So actually, when you write an article, actually the reviewers can come there and use it. So technically, there's so many products out there. I mean, it doesn't make any big difference than other one, except that it's designed to work with that other tools that researchers currently use. So this is like an example of one of the projects. You can actually see, you can have wikis, you can have components, so many things. I'm not going to walk through it, but you can go to the website and find. One of the things that we find interesting, because we have version control, so technically like I'm working on an article and then I post it, so you can actually have a track of all the change happened in these documents. And you can actually define if there will be a public access to it, open access or closed access. But one of the agreements you have, you cannot have anything behind password for more than 4 years. You can have an embargo up to 4 years, and then it should be available publicly. One of the things that's actually good for it is actually to provide DOI, GUID, and that creates persistence links for any component there, not just the article, which actually is something you can see it in Altmetrics. You can actually use data. You can actually get the wiki. So it's not just citation metrics. It's any usage for any component of your project. So this is actually what I want to talk about. So it's an open source software, and it's designed to work with other existing products in the market. So you can see it, you know, this is kind of example. Let's say I have a project in GitHub. I can actually link what I have in GitHub with my OSF project. If I have an Amazon Web Cloud, if I have Fixture, if I have Dataverse, so this is the kind of existing component that researchers use nowadays and actually can connect them during the framework. So I have a central place can link to different components happening around there. So you can see it here, the Open Science Framework is now compatible with, you can actually link between Fixture, the Google Docs, Dataverse, Amazon, Dropbox, and other ones. The other ones still in progress. The one actually I tried to test is with Mendeley and Zotero, because that's a citation management software. So you can actually use what you have in those kind of bibliographic management software to work closely with OSF. Now they actually offered grant in September for other components to provide integration with OSF, including the open journal system, Galaxy, and actually Ubiquiti, that the one was in my former presentation, will be integrated with OSF. Right, Brian?
That's right.
Yeah. So that's an example of a project. It's called Reproducible Search, and that gave you an idea what open science is. So in the past 4 years, more than 250 researchers in psychology have picked the highly cited papers in psychology, including the authors, and start to reproduce those research. And those research actually was posted in highly cited journal, not open access. And the results had been shared in August 28 in Science magazine. And after it's been published, this is actually what the media talk about. Nature actually mentioned this reproducible search, and this is what's the key, what's going on in psychology. And this actually coming from The Guardian. And this is actually from New York Times, said many psychology findings not as strong as claimed. Because for 4 years, even the authors of those papers had been in this reproducible experiment. Currently, this is the kind of project that based on the experience is mainly on cancer biology. And so far, there are actually 50 researchers working on, and it's ongoing so far. So hopefully, we can have more of what we call meta science and this kind of advantage of open science. I'm done. Thank you.
So thank you to our first five panelists. We're now going to take about 15 minutes to invite reactions from our panelists and or responses amongst one another. And in order to sort of tease out some of the issues or considerations that we've talked about so far, after which we'll take about 10 minutes to hear from our last two panelists. And then after that, we have about 20 minutes for open answers and questions with everyone here. So who would like to speak first from the panel in terms of any thoughts of what you've heard from your fellow panelists? Can I open up the floor to anyone? Carrie.
To my friend on the left. He was asked about how this is going to be enforced. And yet they have a policy, and they don't know how they're going to do it. To me, that's not good. You gave us lots of nice reasons. You know, you can look at communism in principle, and it looks wonderful. How well does it work? And as a researcher on the ground, when you tell me I have to spend a very large amount of my research grant because I don't get any more money, and I have to support fewer students, how does that help science?
With respect to your particular grant, I know you mentioned the CCB and having to click the box. We're not monitoring compliance through the CCB, and since you received your grant before May 1st, 2015, don't have to comply with the policy anyway.
But I'm up for renewal next year.
Great, okay, very good. And now in terms of having to pay, you know, to be published, and that affecting your grant funds. There is, and as you mentioned in your remarks, the green route to deposit in repositories, university repository, disciplinary repository, which is free of charge, of course. So the agencies believe that through that method, researchers can avoid paying, you know, contributing any of their funds towards open access charges, and in that way don't have to, they can keep paying as much as they would otherwise to support their students.
Can I respond?
Yes, please do. Yes.
Very nice, but as I pointed out, in my field, the best journals, you have to pay if you want that open access. So I have a choice. I pay out of my grant, or I don't publish in the best journals. That's not a very good choice.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, when the agencies look at, so at this particular, at the situation now where internationally we have all the major funding agencies coming forward with open access policies, which are very similar to our own, and often much more stringent than our own in terms of compliance measures, we just believe that the academic community, the scholarly community, the publishing community will adapt. And as we've seen in with the other presentations today, and in many fields they are adapting. I mean, I know that in fields that I follow, certain fields in philosophy, for example, you know, you say you have three journals which are very well-respected journals. The one might indeed have an embargo period that is 24 months, which would be difficult for Shirk-funded research to. They would either have to pay or, you know, the 24-month embargo. They couldn't comply to our policy under those conditions. However, there are other highly reputable, respectable journals in the field that either have an embargo period that would allow them to comply or no embargo period at all, which in fact is an open access journal, which to me has good people publishing it and seems very highly regarded. So whereas I definitely can't speak to your field or to many fields at all, we do believe that there is a movement in the academic community, the publishing community, a positive movement, which will be beneficial to the research enterprise and will not limit people from publishing where they want to.
Do any of the other panelists have any comments? Simon, and then David.
Yeah, just a question for Kerry. I feel you're the tractor on the panel, so I'll have a go at you. So I think one of the big questions that open access brings up is what do you consider the best journal? So I think at the moment our view of what the best journal is a very traditional view of a paid subscription to a very highly cited journal in traditional metrics, and we all know that there's huge problems with traditional metrics and counting of impacts of research actually on the community on improving people's health, for example, in the healthcare world. So I guess it challenges that notion because now we can have a lot of other models that have come from this concept of open access that do challenge that foundation of what do you think are the best journals?
Okay, I guess there are two issues here. Best journals are where the best papers are published in terms of the impact on the discipline. And impact on the discipline, I don't mean impact factors, I mean impact on the discipline. But there's the other issue, there's no free lunch. Who is going to pay? And again, you have to be very careful comparing the UK and the US, and even in Canada, the cultures in CHR and the funding model in CHR, the funding model in SHRC, I gather it's funding part of your journal, the funding model in NSERC are all different, yet they have the same policy. You still have to check off this same box on the common CV, and we still don't know what the implication is, but somebody has to pay. And what this is going to do, one way or another, is move to transfer the costs to the researcher. Because who else is going to pay?
So next I have...
directly or indirectly.
Sorry, Gary.
Sorry?
I was going to cut you off. I apologize. I thought you were finished. You finished?
Well, I was going to go on, but I'll
stop. Okay. Well, I'd like to give David a chance to speak, and then I see Brian would like to speak as well.
Yeah, I don't dispute that who is going to pay is a big question. However, I don't see that as an ultimate barrier. We're in a period of transition right now. So in many ways, the changes that are going on are going to seem, they will disrupt what used to be the case. And that means for a short period of time, however long that's going to be, there's going to be a lot of disruption and a lot of uncertainty about what will emerge from this. What I do have a problem with in this context is some of the generalizations that are made about open access by people who are opposed to some of the models. And I liked what you said in general, but I did have some questions for the idea that somehow the idea that open access journals are necessarily of a lesser quality, necessarily less well peer-reviewed, necessarily, you know, in many ways not likely to be so highly rated or whatever as other journals. And that simply is, that may have been the case at the beginning, but it's increasingly less and less the case. But at the same time, the number of open access journals is undoubtedly expanding because it's a capitalist environment. You're going to get people trying to take advantage of anything in capitalism. It's not a problem of open access, it's a problem of capitalism. So you're going to get predatory publishers the same way you get criminals in every domain. And the existence of those criminals does not undermine the argument for open access in itself. In the same way that the existence of criminals on the streets does not undermine the reason for you going outside. You know, that's not a logical argument against open access. So I think we are in a dangerous and difficult period, and there are ways we could go that would be really damaging. And one of those ways would be to download all the costs onto the research that you're saying, but that's not necessarily the way it could go. And the Shirk model of funding journals in Canada is a really good one. There are other models one could think of through general taxation increases of various kinds, and maybe now we've got rid of Stephen Harper. This might change. Sorry for the intrusion of politics. We might actually get a bit more funding. We might actually get a bit more funding into these kind of schemes within Canada. Let's hope.
Well, thank you, David. I want to give Brian a chance to say a few words.
I just wanted to say I think we are in a big transition period, and we don't know even what some of the funding models will be. But we already spend an enormous amount of money on journal subscriptions. I mean, and we're paying time after time after time for journals just to rent them year after year. And if that money simply went into paying for individual articles, we would save a considerable amount of money. So what we, in my mind, we need to do is start transitioning away from the subscription model and start reallocating library budgets. So you have examples of things like the Open Library of the Humanities now, which is you know, taking small subscriptions from libraries to pay for open access journals and making them completely free for authors. We also have a situation now where the Dutch government and some Dutch universities have paid for 5 years to help transition journals in the field of linguistics across. And we have now mass numbers of journals, very highly ranked journals in that field, that are going to transition across initially to publish with us, with money provided by the government and the universities, but then in the long term with money provided by the Open Library of the Humanities. So you're starting to see some experiments and some models which work, which don't require any money to come from research budgets. They're coming from the place where the money already is allocated in subscriptions.
Thank you, Brian. Rosarie, do you have any comments?
I just wanted to add just a note in terms of very much recognizing the issue in terms of cost. Somebody does need to cover the cost of publishing. I think it is fair to say in terms of the library perspective that some of the high subscription costs, and some of them can be incredibly high, some of that, in fact, does go towards inflating the publisher profit margin, you might say. And I think it's worth noting this. I mean, I guess I'm just going to read out one of a number of, I guess in terms of pressure that is being put on now towards publishers that is coming from the research community. In October of this month, the League of European Research Universities has put out a statement which is called Christmas is Over, Research Funding Should Go to Research, Not to Publishers. And I think that is very much a campaign that's coming out from the research community, in this case across the European Union, that is saying, look, we absolutely do not want to take funding from researchers. The funding needs to stay with the research community, but we do need to redress, in many cases, the large profits that some publishers, it's certainly commercial publishers, make on the back of research. Just to acknowledge that I think pressure is coming to research, to publishers.
Any comments, Carrie?
Yeah, I've got many concerns. One is that this is going to, you know, my good friend, the VP administration was in this room. She'd be probably saying, wow, this is a good opportunity to redirect some university budget. So we take the money away from library subscriptions, use it for something else the university needs it for, and the researchers pay. Because at the end of the day, one way or another, the researchers are going to be paying. If I hope you're right, more money goes to the granting councils. Mm-hmm. But actually, I would like to see that money going to fund research. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get more going out. And the reality is, you do have to pay, one way or another. You've got to pay. And most of these companies, I'm sure this company up here is very altruistic, but most of them are actually in it to make a profit. And sure, they're not Elsevier or somewhere else at the moment. But you just look at them increase their fees over time. You just watch them.
But that's what's happening with existing publishers.
Yeah. Well, I don't mind a bit of competition, but I don't want to be paying for it out of my research grant.
Elsevier is one of the worst.
Yeah, absolutely. But they're not the only one. The professional societies are exactly the same.
We're not.
Well, you're not big enough yet. You haven't been around. Let me tell you a little story.
Around 15.
Yeah, well, actually,
just time check. No. We do have about 4 minutes, I think, for the panel to have this discussion. But I did want to just, 2 minutes. But the fact of we're talking about predatory journals, and David, you mentioned that you think over time we'll see a reduction in those numbers. There's a really interesting paper
I think we'll see an increase.
Well, there's a very interesting article someone sent to me as a result of us advertising this event, and it's I can send it out. I think it's a PubMed publication, but it's a statistical analysis of all the predatory journals. It's quite telling, actually, but it's a real concern, and the rising article processing charges. But I just want to give our other panelists an opportunity to say a few words, if you have any. Yes, Jeff?
Describing and the fact that it would tie into such a broad range of other existing tools, Figshare, Dataverse, and others that people are using. So I'll be certainly following up with you on that. But it's sort of one of the goals is to try and lessen the burden on researchers. So if you've done something once, we don't want you to have to do it again and again and again. So I was intrigued by that.
Okay, well, thank you. This has opened up a lot of interesting discussion, and as I mentioned later, we'll have an opportunity for all of us to participate. And so thank you, everyone. And now just to transition us to our final theme, which is what should Queen's do to support research dissemination and funder open access requirements? And I welcome Rosarie Coughlin, scholarly publishing librarian. And Rosarie, what efforts are underway in the library to support Queen's community in research dissemination and meeting funder requirements of open access, in particular, the Tri-Council policy on open access publications? Thank you. Just get that together.
Okay, thanks, Corina. You're welcome. Great, so thanks very much, Corina. So really what I've put up there is four, I guess, touch points or keywords for addressing this whole question. I guess starting with the first one there, in terms of, you know, thinking about sharing, I think the library is one, as we can see today, of a number of partners that is interested in, I think, the shared underlying goal of increasing dissemination, increasing readership and activity around research that is output by the university, by whatever means that really does enhance and enable that. The green, really, yes, I think, you know, one of our panelists has spoken to this, at least so far, in terms of coming back to how is the library supporting funder researchers in complying with funder requirements. We do come on board with the green model, which is that no-cost enabler. So as our panelists have mentioned, in terms of the tri-agency policy on publications, there is, yes, the article processing charges if you publish in a gold open access journal. The free route for, which is allowed by 75% of our commercial publishers, is for authors to put up their peer-reviewed accepted manuscript into our repository, which is QSpace, which we we will be developing and evolving over the next few months to really what we hope to be to deliver keen added value services for our research community in terms of looking at who is reading our work, where is that readership coming from, etc. And as I've mentioned, we are very much partnering, so we are looking to keep keen in our mind in developing our service around QSpace will be to reduce any burden of effort or duplication on our research community for capturing publication data. So we're looking to partner with research services and other support infrastructure on campus. The second point that I want to make really is, if I could say there were four things that I would be keen to encourage researchers to do. When you're thinking about knowledge dissemination, when you're writing your proposals for research grants or your mid-term reporting or the end of grant award reporting, do think about how potentially open access, if your audience is people beyond academia, so that could be Joe Public, health workers, policy workers, journalists, etc. Open access for that dissemination, knowledge dissemination piece does address and speak to that. So again, we would be keen to work with you in leveraging that in your proposals. I would encourage researchers to save your accepted manuscript, keenly the version that's been peer-reviewed. It's the version that you own copyright to, and keep it aside on your computer. And as we said, most publishers allow you to put that into QSpace or a subject repository of your choice, like PubMed Central, etc. Retain your copyright, whether that is rights to reuse your work, rights to share it to people that you want to share it with. So, you know, read your copyright transfer agreement, retain the rights to disseminate early, i.e. via our repository. And the fourth key thing would be unique. So if you haven't already set up what is now becoming kind of a globally recognized research identifier, time's up, so set up an ORCID ID. So that would be a mechanism for you to ensure you get correct attribution for all of your works, whether it's research publications, teaching, awards, grants. Many funders now require an ORCID ID. It is being linked into other services like Web of Science, etc. So thank you very much.
And next, we have our final panelist, Jeff Moon. So my question for you, Jeff, and I'm speaking here at the mic because I don't project very well, but the other component is research data management and dissemination, also a requirement of many funders, particularly in the U.S. Jeff, can you tell us about national efforts to support this launch of the National Data Management Planning Tool? Jeff.
Start me yet. All right. Is that better?
Yep.
Okay. I'm here to talk to you about Portage, which is an organization dedicated to supporting Canadian innovation through shared expertise and stewardship of research data. So we're moving away from articles to the actual underlying raw data that makes up the research process. Portage is an organization with many partners, and you can see some of them here. And one of the main outputs of the Portage network is the DMP Assistant, the Data Management Planning Assistant, a web-based bilingual data management planning tool made available to all researchers in Canada through the Portage network. Portage DMP Expert Group was responsible for developing this, and we have representatives from across Canada doing this. We started meeting in February of 2015. And we had 12 teleconferences and lots of behind-the-scenes work, both among the expert group, but also on the ground at the University of Montreal, Université de Montréal, and Alberta. What we've come up with is this. If you go to portagenetwork.ca, you will land on the DMP assistant. And the first thing you would do is either sign in if you've got an account or sign up if you don't. Once you've logged in, you can create a new plan. The default template is the Portage template, but there is the opportunity for local branding. We have not taken up that challenge at Queen's yet. We're just launching today, so we'll do that somewhere in the future. Once you've clicked on Create Plan, you get right into the tool. There are four tabs you have to work through. The first tab gives you plan details, and you're supposed to provide information there about your research project, including, as you can see there, an ORCID ID. I believe there's somewhere on there there's a place for an ORCID ID. I don't see that. Principal Investigator Researcher ID. Second thing you have to work on, the second tab, is the meat of the data management planning process. It's questions related to the development of a data management plan. And if you click on that, you can see there are seven categories or sections dealing with those elements that we, the expert group, felt were important to data management, from data collection to storage and backup, right down to ethics and legal compliance. Looking into one of these in more detail, data collection, there are three questions associated with data collection. The first question is, what types of data will you collect, create, link to, and acquire, etc.? If you don't know quite what we mean by that, there's some guidance. And if you open that guidance up, it'll tell you, well, we mean this. And so for every question, there is some guidance provided. The next step is sharing. And sharing the data involves adding collaborators and setting permissions for access to your data management plan. And finally, you can export your plan. And the plan can be exported in a number of formats, depending on your needs. And in addition, you can export in somewhat of a granular fashion those elements of the plan that you think are important for the purposes you're working on. So, for example, you can export administrative details or certain aspects of your plan. So, for example, if you're looking at knowledge mobilization, you might choose to export just one section, maybe on sharing and reuse. This is what a plan looks like when exported, or at least the top end of a plan. We're very excited to be here in Open Access Week and launching. And in order to access this, you'd go to portagenetwork.ca, and you would land on this page. Eventually, there'll be more of a page, but right now it lands directly in the DMP assistant. And I'm ready for questions, and everybody else is too, I'm sure.
Thank you, Jeff. That's pretty exciting news. We've all been waiting for that. So now that we've heard from all of our panelists, we have about 20 minutes for audience questions and answer period and more discussion from the panelists as well. And if you have a question, I'll go over and give the mic to you just to make sure that everyone can hear and our guest, Brian, via Skype can hear as well. So would anyone like to start with a question for our panelists? At the back, Anthony.
Sorry, hello. I have two questions, but I'll start with the smaller one about ownership. So the question is, will the requirements of the open access policy provide exemptions to researchers conducting research with Aboriginal communities that follow OCAP, which is put out by First Nations Information Governance Center, which recognizes Aboriginal communities' right to control the research data and publication of research data? Does that make sense to you? Okay.
Well, currently, the Tri-Agency Open Access Policy on Publications just pertains to publications, with the exception of the CIHR requirement, which I'm not very familiar with. And I hate to say this, but you'd have to follow up with CIHR to understand how they approach that requirement. The agencies just this summer released a draft statement of principles on digital data management as a step in their process towards developing data management requirements. And in that statement, it does mention that one of the expectations with respect to data management planning is that all ethical and commercial obligations are taken into account, and that would include obligations for First Nations.
Any other questions? Anthony, another question. Yes.
Sorry, I have a second question. This one's lengthier, excuse me, but I got to read it, okay? Okay, so the Tri-Agency Open Access Policy on Publications states that the Open Access Policy includes research publications and data. Further down the document, it restricts the sharing data, which you just referred to the CIHR-funded research, and specifically to bioinformation, atomic, and molecular coordinate data. SHRC Research Data Archiving Policy, which was last modified on April 8, 2014, states, all research data collected with the use of SHRC funds must be preserved and made available for use by others within a reasonable period of time. And a reasonable period of time is defined as within 2 years. Lastly, on the government's webpage, science.gc.ca, in answer to the question, does data have to be openly accessible or archived under the new policy? The answer provided is, the agencies encourage researchers and trainees to make their research data available as a best practice and to increase the dissemination of research findings. So my question is, what is or is there a timeline for requiring researchers to share their data after completion of the research project?
Okay, with respect to CIHR's requirements, as I said, you'd have to follow up with them. With respect to SHRC's data archiving policy, that policy goes back perhaps 25 years, 1990, yeah. It's actually a non-mandatory policy, so you can take that with a grain of salt. But in terms of what SHRC will recommend in terms of sharing data, if and when it ever comes to that, I think that SHRC and the tri-agencies generally will really have to work with the academic community. And really, I think it would be the academic communities, as disciplinary communities, would really have to take the lead in determining what types of guidelines with respect to data sharing would be appropriate for those fields. So, for some fields, perhaps in the health sciences, the consensus in the disciplinary community might be that data should be shared upon publication of the research paper, and perhaps there'd be other fields who would come to the decision that what's best for that field is for data to be released at maybe after the publication or... But as of right now, SHRC researchers are not required to share data, although it's encouraged in the data archiving policy.
Yes, go ahead, Jeff.
A voluntary data deposit policy is but as good as a voluntary long-form census, if you know what I mean.
Good point.
And I'm not impugning the policy. They had a policy way before we were even talking about this.
Yes.
But it took maybe until about 4 years ago for us to get a phone call from the Surveillance Studies Project saying, we're reading our SHRC requirements and we're supposed to deposit. Are you the right people? And after we picked ourselves up off the floor, because we'd never gotten a call from SHRC-funded researchers before, we proceeded to deposit the surveillance studies research on surveillance from about 4 or 5 years ago. But it was really, really, that was the first time we'd encountered a SHRC researcher.
Okay.
Actually, I have a question, and I think this is for you, Brian. I'm not so sure if you have the answers or not, but in the UK, and just looking at the policies of the federal funders in terms of open access, and I know data management plans have been there for a while, but in terms of open access, can you speak to how compliance is achieved if there is a sort of a federal research funder policy on open access?
I think they're looking into compliance now. They were a bit scared to try and enforce anything at first because they did meet quite a bit of pushback from some sections of the community initially, and they really just wanted to get funding through initially. But we do have now, for example, the Wellcome Trust, which says that if you don't deposit your articles as open access and your data, I think is coming as well, then you won't receive another grant from them. And a lot of researchers depend on the Wellcome Trust and others for their funding of their whole career. So we're expecting a lot of compliance there.
Oh, my. I guess so, yeah. Yes. Yes, it would. Any other questions from the audience for our panelists? Okay. Okay, we'll start Sharon first.
Nasser, I'm just curious about who is moderating the Open Science Framework.
It's a non-for-profit organization. It's the center is called Community of Science. It's based on Charlottesville, Virginia. So it started with a group of researchers from the University of Virginia at the time. And the funding is coming up from Sloan Foundation. and coming, some of them actually coming now from National Science Foundation. So it's mainly an American one, but actually one of the good things about this initiative, they do have $250,000, and actually this is the money will be used to maintain the system whenever just actually, you know, there's, you know, a non-continuation of fund. So I think that's something, you know, is really interesting about that. So technically it's, this is just one aspect of the project of what the center is doing. And one of the things I probably just, you know, mention about the guidelines, because if you have a chance to look at the center website, they actually developed the guidelines for open access publishing and open access, you know, how to deposit data and so on. However, it's made in American context, but actually it's really useful for organizations to look at this one. And they have position if you want to apply there, go ahead.
Okay, David and then Rosari.
I actually wanted to ask a question to all the other panelists, and it's about another aspect of this, which is, we mentioned the question of reviewing earlier on, the quality of reviewing and how important that has been in academic life, but also how much, what hasn't been mentioned is how much recently that's come under challenge in various fields in terms of both the ethics of reviewing and how much reviewing is really being fulfilled in practice, and also, again, this quality is being adjusted by speed and everything else. And I, one interesting model I saw was that actually an open model of reviewing, which some journal areas are now pursuing, where a paper is published online as a, not as a first, as a pre-review copy, and then reviewers openly, anybody can actually, who's a confirmed expert in the field, registered, can actually review that online, and the papers gradually iterates. And I wonder if that kind of model might be another way in which sort of certain kinds of challenges are going to occur to changing the way that publication takes place. And if anybody had some experience with this or thoughts about this model?
I'll respond.
Oh, Carrie? Carrie and then Brian. Carrie first.
I think we're having a serious problem with reviewing. Mm-hmm,
I agree.
Not because of poor reviewers, but because of their being overwhelmed by the amount of material that you're dealing, you know, having to send out to review. And as I mentioned in my opening comments, one of the things that I'm seeing is a problem with these new journals sending stuff out to reviewers, wanting responses very quickly, and good people can't respond that quickly. So what they say no. And so many papers are being published without proper review, or not reviewed by the people who should be reviewing them, at least in my field, that's all I can speak to. And I'm actually seeing papers published that I have seen before and know have been rejected and know that comments on them and know what's wrong with them, but they're out there. The other thing that's happening, and it's with increasing frequency, unfortunately, is that this is becoming a vehicle for increased plagiarism. Now, we've had plagiarism for a long time, but I've seen much more of it in the last few years. And again, it used to get picked up at the reviewer stage of the journal. Now it's not getting picked up there. It's going out and being published. I had to deal with one fairly recently, one in actually involving some of my work. And it's got so ridiculous that people will even publish almost the entire paper. The only thing they change is the name, the author. And they're getting away with it. Now, eventually, we catch up with some of them, but there's such a proliferation of journals, and how do people keep up with it? And that's a big concern I've got. So reviewers are being overloaded, and as I said at the beginning, I blame the editors for this, because one of the jobs of an editor is to look at and say, is this even worth sending out for review? And if you don't do that screening, it just kills your review process.
Thank you, Carrie. Quite shocking. And Brian, you wanted to say a few words?
Yeah, I just want to say, I think sometimes we slightly idealize peer review or the way it's been done in the past. We slightly over-romanticize it. I mean, I believe incredibly strongly in it. I think it's incredibly important. But, I mean, up until now, a lot of subscription or print publishers haven't peer-reviewed monographs at all, for example. We know, you know, out of the top three big publishers, they don't peer-review their monographs or their textbooks. So as an open access publisher, we actually go in the opposite direction. We're so concerned about our image as a quality publisher and not being tarnished by the predatory publisher group that we go out of our way to make it very clear that all the books are peer reviewed, exactly how they've been reviewed, and we make the reviews available if the reviewers agree to it. And we make sure that they're fully anti-plagiarism screened and that kind of thing, and that that's available for people to see as well. And that we follow, you know, Committee on Publication Ethics guidelines and things like that. I think we go further in following all those sorts of guidelines and doing those sorts of things than other publishers do, because we have to prove ourselves in some way. I think you might start to see that the major open access publishers in some ways are improving the situation. Certainly in terms of things like books being peer-reviewed where they weren't at all before.
Thank you, Brian. And now Simon would like to say a few words.
Just a quick comment on something David brought up about that open peer review. So a little bit different to what you mentioned, but certainly with Biomed Central, who we publish with, a lot of their journals are open peer review. And so that means that the author knows who the reviewers are, the reviewers know who the authors are, but also they actually publish the peer reviews alongside the final published article. So as an increased, so it's not just open access to the finished product, you can actually go back and look at the previous version of the articles. And as a peer reviewer, you take a different perspective because you think, oh, someone, if this thing gets published, someone's going to read my review at some point, not just the editor and the authors. So it sort of changes the landscape a little as far as the way that you approach peer reviewing an article. So it's all, again, all part of this open access movement, I think.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. Nasser, comments?
To add to this, I mean, I think we need to review how we look at peer review, going on, and look at how research is produced. And when I mentioned about the example of psychology, I mean, all the journals and all the research had been done in peer-reviewed journals, subscribed journals. So technically, I mean, it was peer-reviewed, but it's not verifiable research. It's not, something that you can build on it as results. So I think the whole concept of quality, that the problem with open access is low quality, I think that doesn't exist anymore, because it doesn't mean that all subscribed content that we pay millions of dollars for it is of high quality. But the problem of publishers, that they actually have very bad practices when they deal with librarians or the libraries, because we can't buy the journals we want. We have to take packages of many other journals, that some of them really, really of low quality, but this is how they work. So I think the whole idea of the publication model and how publishers approach users who actually are the authors of the articles should be actually be reviewed as well.
Good comment. And Jeff, you had a comment as well?
Yeah, I was going to say that this seems like a natural evolution toward improving peer review with open access. And in the context of data, I'm just wondering how a reviewer would successfully evaluate a paper if he or she only has access to that which is present in the paper, a table, a graph, a chart, a statistical result, if they don't themselves have access to the raw data that generated that table, chart, graph, or statistical result. And so I think that the move toward open access to research data is only going to improve the peer review process, because fake data, poor data, data you can't conjure up is going to raise red flags in the review process.
Just as a follow-up to that, though, would then the expectation be that the peer reviewer is actually reviewing the data as well? Like, would you have time to
read
the data? It's a good point, but I was just wondering.
My thinking
that's
is
that why open peer review is slightly, possibly better, because you don't have to go through this process of demanding every time a certain person, targeting groups of people who you have a certain number of people whose expertise is verified in some way. And then it doesn't actually matter which particular person is, which particular people are the reviewers. So some people can review data, some people can review things. So ideally, that's how it works. As you say, it's an ideal that at the moment doesn't exist.
Brian, okay, yes.
Yeah, just a very quick one. I just want to say it's also important if the authors know that their data is going to be possibly reviewed, they tend to be a little bit more scrupulous in preparing it. And I think they've done studies, I think it was with psychology papers, that there were far fewer statistical errors in papers which had open data than papers that didn't. And it wasn't because the other authors were cheating, it's just that the others were a bit more careful.
Ah, very good. Any other questions from the audience here? Panelists? I actually have a question for Simon, and I was intrigued by the fact that the professional organizations are paying, relate in your profession, are paying for the article processing charges, which is fabulous. I'm just wondering if anyone is seeing that for other open source journals. Is that something that maybe Jeremy you've seen, or I mean it's very good. It's one way of supporting getting the research published.
Is that when we were discussing the question of costs, it seemed like we were discussing it in terms of private companies who were grading journals and the researchers. But from what I'm seeing in the community, there's a lot of work going on into different types of cooperative publishing arrangements between libraries and scholarly journals and so on, and various types of agreement. And I find that very encouraging because I think many people recognize that the money is in the system. It's all about how it's being allocated. And if we could only figure out a better way of allocating these resources, it would be to the benefit of a great many people, including the research enterprise.
Oh, Rosari.
Just in terms of, to I guess, plug, things are evolving to the extent also that libraries are looking for opportunities to maybe move into libraries and often... Yeah. Or, you know, universities, as it were, to actually operate as a publisher. So, for example, here at Queen's, we do have a journal hosting service that provides the online infrastructure for peer review, submission, and also then disseminating as an electronic journal. So for any faculty members or students here at Queen's, and I know many universities are doing this, and it's a new area, it's an evolving area for libraries, but I think it does demonstrate that some of the traditional roles of strictly publisher and library, you know, that things are changing. Yeah.
Okay. David.
Just a final point on issues around how, I mean, one of the pressures that Kerry mentioned earlier on was to do with publishing in very high quality journals was basically it's a career pressure. It's a question of, you know, do you get tenure? Do you get promoted? Do you get a job? And one of the interesting things is I think what also has to change is the way in which academic jobs are evaluated and academic performance is evaluated, and it is changing. One of the reasons I got the job I got, the Canada Research Chair in Surveillance Studies, is because of my contribution in organizing the field of surveillance studies through the journal I run. And, you know, I haven't necessarily published in some of the top journals that other scholars might have published in because I've sacrificed that in order to be an academic organizer. And in the terms of the committee I had and the people who assessed me, that was recognized. Queen's recognized that as a contribution. And I think that kind of more flexible approach to understanding what is an academic contribution is also required. It's not just that we should put up with the traditional ways that we have been assessed as academics and just fit into a box every time. I think we've got to start to argue our case for how we are assessed and to change the nature of the way that universities and academics relate. And that is something that I think is happening slowly, but also needs to change quicker.
Thank you, David. Any other comments? Questions? Well, I think this ends our panel discussion. I want to thank our panelists. I'm going to be passing things off to Sharon Murphy, and she will say our final concluding remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to say a special thank you to David because I knew that he had to get out to a 2:30 class. Well, I want to thank each one of you. It's been wonderful participation. I have no doubt that you're going to have more discussions with our panelists, with each other. I really want to thank our panelists. Each one of you has brought great experience and insights. We appreciate your time and how articulate and thoughtful you've been. There are more events going on for Open Access Week, and if you were to Google on the library's site or the university's site, it will take you to a page that has a list of webinars and different activities that are available for you to take part in. Of course, they are all free in the spirit of Open Access. Many of these webinars are stored and available for some time, so if you want to go to the site and see what's available and then look at it at your leisure or share it with friends. Earlier, Rosari referred to a statement written by the League of European Research Universities, quite a new one, advocating for open science, and it reads in part, "In the era of open science, open access to publications is one of the cornerstones of the new research paradigm, and business models must support this transition."
Soon, Principal Wolf will be signing in support of that declaration on behalf of Queen's University. So we thought that's another lovely open access event, as it were. So we look forward to carrying on these conversations. Stay tuned for things both formal and informal. Thank you.